Today, I'm in the county which is the birthplace of these iconic military machines. Where am I? Find out as we escape to the country.
Fearful introduction.
I'm getting quite emotional.
And just lavender.
Such a lovely house.
Yeah. It is beautiful. Don't make me cry.
Yeah, no, but then I'll go. And then words fail them in a modern property masterpiece.
Wow.
OMG.
I'm in Dorset, in Bovington, the home of the British tank. Back in 1916, after 2 years of fighting on the continent, trench warfare was at a stalemate. What was needed was an armoured vehicle to penetrate enemy lines. So the British government, in secret, set about testing tanks here in Dorset. Well, later on, I get to go in one. Yes. But in the meantime, they're not the only giants to inhabit this beautiful corner of England.
Dorset shares its borders with the counties of Devon, Somerset, Wiltshire and Hampshire. It also boasts some of the most fascinating coastline in southern England, which were once the stomping ground of the largest creatures that ever existed. Dorset's 95 miles of heritage coast have unearthed some rare and complete dinosaur fossils. And the rocks here reveal a unique cross-section of geology that spans the Triassic, Jurassic and Cretaceous periods, over 100 million years in the making. This county also exhibits another mammoth landmark in the form of a 54-metre chalk man carved on the hillside at Cerne Abbas, whose age and origin is unknown, but has come to symbolise an important part of Dorset's heritage. The county is satisfyingly remote, without any cities or motorways, just a bounty of historic market towns and countless country hamlets, chock full of idyllic homes that present a perfect picture of rural English charm.
If you are thinking of moving here, then you should pray for pennies from heaven, because an average detached house will set you back £312,000. That's a staggering £54,000 above the national figure. And if you want to live near the sea, then you should have very deep pockets indeed, because this county has the most expensive coastal properties in the entire UK, situated just behind me in Sandbanks near Poole. But all is not lost. If you head inland towards Somerset, then you can shave around 10% off the county's national price. But whatever your finances, there are a whole host of period properties to choose from here.
The market town of Bridport has some great examples of Georgian architecture from the 18th and 19th centuries, built on the wealth of its 750-year-old rope-making industry. However, their proximity to the coast makes them pricey. For character and countryside, Dorset is awash with a great range of thatched cottages, such as this traditional longhouse in a rural hamlet just south of Blandford Forum. It offers 5 bedrooms and is currently on the market for just shy of £770,000. Dorset's locally quarried limestone from the Isle of Portland also paints a pretty property picture, giving the region a very distinctive and delightful style. This 5-bedroom home has an asking price of £395,000, and the use of natural stone in its construction belies the fact that it was built just 2 years ago.
As you can see, you're spoilt for choice here, but what are our buyers looking for? Let's meet them and find out.
Legal Secretary Chrissy and her husband John have spent the past 15 years living in a desirable West London suburb, but a recent career change has made them re-evaluate their priorities.
I went to sea shortly after leaving school and travelled the world for some 30-odd years in the Merchant Navy. A year ago, I had the opportunity to take early redundancy and retire, which I decided to do. The thinking behind this was that it would enable me to spend more time with Chrissy.
And they've chosen to drop anchor back in Dorset, where they first found love.
We and Chrissy met 20 years ago. My ship was in Portland Harbour. We hit it off straight away.
We were introduced by a friend. Well, I quite like to move back to Dorset. It's where I met John. It holds many memories for me. And just carry on really where I left off all those years ago.
After a few years of married life there, they relocated back to Chrissy's large childhood home in Chiswick, that's been in her family for some 60 years. But the time has come to swap the city for the country once and for all.
London's got a lot going for it, it really has, but I think we really do hanker for the countryside now. We've done London by selling this house, releasing the funds, downsizing, it will enable us to do that.
Yes, it will help us pursue our dream.
Yeah.
And there's another member of the family who will complete that dream.
I've always liked cats. Lulu now that I have is my second cat, and we got her from a rescue centre. I'm very interested in rescue centres, and it's something, if we had one in the village where we eventually moved to, it's something I'd like to get involved in.
As well as volunteering, socialising is high on the agenda too.
Be nice to mix with the local community.
And meet some new people. As we're not really drivers at the moment, even though we have passed our tests.
We do need some amenities within walking distance.
And some public transport.
Both John and Chrissy are united about their preferred location. But when it comes to the property itself, they're not quite so unanimous.
My ideal house would ideally be something contemporary. Chrissy does prefer some features.
I like a few features, like a wood-burning stove.
Yeah. But I'm willing to compromise.
Yes, yes. Something that gives us a bit of country feel, but something also that's modern.
They will be selling the family house in London to fund the move and have a good idea of what they're prepared to spend on their new Dorset home.
Our budget for the move is £600,000, but for the right property, we'd be willing to extend it to £700,000.
John and Chrissy are looking for a country home west of Poole and east of Dorchester, so we'll be exploring that portion of the county to try to satisfy both their rural and coastal aspirations. Time for me to meet up with our house hunters on Dorset's stunning shores to finalise the finer details of their prospective move.
Hiya.
Hello.
Welcome to Dorset.
Thank you.
I should say welcome back. So why decide on Dorset for this big move then?
Wow, look at the view. You know, it's wonderful living in a place, you know, with a wonderful sea view like that. And, you know, Dorset has a lot of memories for us. We were married in Dorset. Yeah. I met John in Dorset, you know.
I love the fact that you talk about the view and your face is just kind of going, oh.
Yeah. For me, a sea view in a property is not a priority.
Right.
I mean, I'm used to the sea, so I can give it a miss.
So you want the rural view and you want the sea view?
I'd like, well, but just to make John happy, you know, I'd like a sea view in the front, say, and he could have the rural view in the back.
I'm willing to compromise.
Yes.
Well, thank goodness you said that, because I was going to say. Anyway, good luck with your search. See you later. So what are you after in the house?
Detached.
Right.
3 to 4 bedrooms. A nice sized garden for Chrissy, because she loves her gardening.
I do like gardening, yes.
Fairly contemporary.
Yes. Open plan kitchen.
Yeah, open plan kitchen.
Okay. Conservatory, if you can manage.
Right.
That can always be added on if you don't find one.
I was going to say, the list's getting longer and longer.
It is, isn't it?
How much money have we got for this? Because it's quite an expensive county.
Yes, we thought 600,000.
But that'd stretch 7 for the property that hits the spot.
Okay.
700.
All right, I've got three lovely houses to show you. Well, I think they're lovely anyway. Should we get going?
Oh, yes, please.
Come on in.
Yes.
For a maximum budget of £700,000, John and Chrissy are after a detached property with 3 to 4 bedrooms, an open-plan kitchen-diner, and a conservatory. John has a preference for contemporary interiors, but Chrissy is hankering after a few traditional features, as well as a good-sized garden. They're both hoping for a vibrant village with good public transport links, but the jury is out on whether the location is surrounded by fields of green or acres of blue. All in all, it's a tall order, but we do have a fantastic selection of very engaging Dorset properties that we hope will more than meet the mark. And as ever, I won't be revealing the price until the end of each tour. Last, but by no means least, is the Mystery House, which promises to be a real cliffhanger. Our first destination is the village of Farnham in North Dorset. Farnham is a sought-after location within the Cranbourne Chase, where it feels as though time has stood still. Perfectly preserved, whitewashed thatched cottages line the quiet, narrow lanes and completely epitomise a true rural idyll. There isn't a shop within the village, but there is a bus service that passes through a couple of times a day and an inviting 17th century pub with some very friendly locals.
As a man after my own heart, you're living the village dream. How are you?
Yes, well, trying to, certainly.
How long have you been here?
16 years, I think, something like that.
And originally from?
From London.
Ah, right, so... Yes.
We're from London.
Right.
Very similar.
Right, originally a Cockney, believe it or not.
Really? Is it too quiet here?
Ooh, that depends what you want out of life, doesn't it? No, I don't think so.
And what about a community spirit? Because there's no shop.
There isn't, but there is one just over one field. And there are things like events in our local pub. quizzes and rallies and all sorts of things.
So this is called the museum. There's a story behind that, isn't there?
Yes, it's named after the Pitt Rivers Museum, which is just up the top of the hill. And that was a major collection of, well, artifacts from, really from all over the world, but a lot of them from this part of the world.
Listen, we won't keep you. You enjoy your pint. Unfortunately, we can't go to the pub because I've got a house to show you.
Oh, right.
Maybe later.
Yeah,
oh,
maybe later.
We'll
I'll hold this then.
Well, enjoy the house. Yes.
Cheers.
Enjoy the house.
Thank you very much.
Yes. My pleasure.
Right, come on then, guys. It's
okay,
back up this way.
Then.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
All right, bye-bye.
All the best.
This desirable village certainly gets a high recommendation. It's time to see if our first house will get our buyer's seal of approval. It's just a stumbling distance away from the pub.
Ooh.
Ooh, indeed.
Ooh, it's what can it say?
What a beautiful house.
Yeah.
I'm getting quite emotional.
And
just
lavender.
Such a lovely house.
Yeah, John.
I am, it's beautiful.
Oh. It is beautiful.
Don't make me cry.
Yeah, no, but then I'll go. Pretty, isn't it?
It's well maintained.
Yes.
It's very well maintained.
It
and it fits in with the rest of the village, which is, I think, 99% thatch.
I love the door. The door's it really invites you in.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's got character, but it's not over the top.
No.
Well, you know that inviting door?
Yeah. Yes.
It's inviting us in. Come on, let's go.
I'm going.
This very pretty thatched cottage has all the hallmarks of a period property, but was actually built some 14 years ago and manages to combine character features with all the mod cons. Time to see if it's a combination that appeals to Chrissy and John.
Oh, this is a nice... This looks really cosy.
Isn't it?
Yeah. No, I like the size of this room. It's lovely.
Well done.
And it's got a nice outlook to the garden. And
you could put a conservatory out there as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With just planning permission, of course.
Yeah.
So you like it?
First impressions, yes, I do, yeah.
It
does feel a little bit claustrophobic, and maybe
really?
A little bit claustrophobic.
Because I'm thinking we're really lucky to have the size, you know, of ceiling here, the height that you've
definitely.
Got.
And when all said and done, Alan, we are downsizing,
yeah.
So I need to adjust to the size of the house, but it is big enough for two people.
Though they may feel rather snug in the sitting room, I'm very confident they won't be cramped in the next area.
Well,
oh, my word.
This is lovely.
Isn't it just?
It is. It's just a right size kitchen.
That's beautiful. Beautiful ceiling.
Yeah.
Kind of a vaulted ceiling. Plenty of space.
Yeah.
Kitchen diner.
The kitchen.
Travertine floor.
Yeah.
Underfloor heating.
Yeah.
Oh.
You've got this lovely little breakfast bar as well.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
And then you've got this enormous table in here for dining. I think this is where you'd spend most of your time, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, you would, anyway.
Yeah.
I'd be waiting in there by the cosy fire.
Lovely.
Oh,
yes.
You would, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
I think if the sun's out, you know, this room would be fantastic.
Yeah.
It really would.
Mm.
Yeah. So you like it?
Mm. So far, so good, as they say.
Quite nice, yeah.
Quite nice?
Yeah.
Let's go upstairs.
This house is actually laid out over three stories, with the top floor completely given over to a long and large double bedroom. Back down a level on the first floor are the three remaining bedrooms that include two light and roomy doubles, one of which is currently being used as a study, and this sits right next to the family bathroom, but I'm showing them the room which could be theirs.
And this is the master. Come on in.
Oh, this is a nice-sized
good
room,
size,
yes.
Good size, yeah.
Very nice
ensuite
size.
As well.
Ensuite as well.
Very
yes.
modern ensuite.
Yeah. Can we have a look?
Yeah, go and pop your head down.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Oh, nice shower for John.
Yeah, that's a good size, yeah.
Bright enough, isn't it?
It is,
it's
a
bright,
nice size.
Really.
Have you got a lot of clothes?
Yes. I think I'd have to have a walk-in wardrobe. Have we
that's
got
handy, isn't it?
For one? Oh, magnificent. This is my room, then.
Yeah, I don't know where I'm sleeping.
Before poor John gets turfed out altogether, let's turn our attention to the garden. It's mainly later lawn wrapping itself all around the property. This house also benefits from a barn-style double garage.
So, nice garden, isn't it?
It is very nice.
Beautiful, wraparound garden.
It's a big house, you know.
Yeah.
It is
I know you're
house.
Coming from a big house, but
yes.
for the both of you, I would say you wouldn't want anything bigger
rooms.
Than that, really,
no.
would you?
No, you're right, you are right.
So what do you reckon it's on the market for?
I would say 675.
£675,000?
Yes.
OK, how about you?
Well, I think I'm going to go in lower.
Right.
I'm going to say 635.
It's currently in the market for £565,000.
Really?
Oh, that's surprising.
It's well
yeah.
worth that.
Well, yeah. we'll go back in and have a look okay. around, mm-hmm. and I'll be by the front.
Okay.
Smelling
okay.
the lavender.
And
rather
the roses.
Nice. And the roses. I always smell the roses. Come on, off you go.
Right, thank
okay,
you, Alex.
Then.
Thank you.
Take your time, yeah?
Thank you very much.
Comfortably under budget at £565,000, this charming recently built thatched cottage has the visual appeal of a more historic property. It comes with a superb country-style kitchen-diner, living areas that offer a few traditional features, and scope to build a conservatory with the right planning permissions. There are four bedrooms to choose from, as well as a good-sized garden, and the whole lot is set in a picturesque rural village.
First impressions of the house as we walked up through the gate from outside, it quite took my breath away, maybe quite emotional, because it is a beautiful looking house.
What do you think of this room?
It's a strange space.
And look at this, you just banged your head on there as
yeah.
well. I don't know, it's I could see it being more of a storage area. When I came through the gate, I saw the front of the house with its lovely porch and roses, and I thought, oh, this is lovely. Just what you would imagine, a chocolate box house. But some of the rooms could have been a bit bigger, especially upstairs.
And you're still smiling.
Hello.
Seen enough?
Yes, yes.
See what that lavender
yes.
smells gorgeous, and yes. the roses. Beautiful. Jump in the car?
Yes, please.
Come
yeah.
on.
Yeah.
Set amongst the rolling hills behind Dorset's Chesil Beach is the beautiful village of Abbotsbury, home to the remains of Abbotsbury Abbey, whose Benedictine monks established a swanery here back in the 11th century. As Chrissy is keen to get involved with animal welfare, during the week we arranged for our buyers to meet the swanery's general manager, John Houston, to discover more about this ancient natural habitat of nesting mute swans.
The swanery, we think, started in around the 1040s, when the Benedictine monks established a monastery on the hill at Abbotsbury village just behind us. The swans were already here, so the monks were really taking advantage of a wonderful source of free food.
Does anybody actually eat swan in this day and age?
No, no. The swans are protected. Most swans are owned by the Queen, except uniquely here at Abbotsbury,
yeah.
the swans are owned by the Ilchester Estates, who purchased Abbotsbury off Henry VIII in 1541.
Okay.
The feathers from our Abbotsbury swans are used by Lloyd's of London to record sunken ships in their Book of Doom. And they've assured me that they would have used an Abbotsbury quill
oh,
to record
yes,
the sinking
yeah.
of the Titanic.
Oh, dear, a lot of history.
It's
yeah.
amazing,
history.
Isn't it?
At any given time, at least 1,000 swans feed and shelter in the lagoon, and the hatching of the first cygnet traditionally signifies the start of summer.
This is the only colony of mute swans you can visit anywhere in the world. And they're drawn here by the perfect five-star swan conditions.
Yeah.
The eelgrass in the water is one of their favourite foods. The freshwater streams are ideal for cygnets in their early stages because
yeah.
they can't tolerate seawater.
Yeah.
John, do swans make good parents?
On the whole, yes. But occasionally, for odd reasons, we get abandoned cygnets, and it might be they're a bad parent, or perhaps the parents have been attacked by a predator, like a fox.
Mm-hmm.
In those sad circumstances, we have our adoption pens to look after the cygnets who've been abandoned.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to see them?
I'd love to.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's over this way.
Yes.
There are five of these pens at the swanery, which provide sanctuary to neglected cygnets before they can hopefully return to their natural environment.
Abandoned cygnets get put in here with a good family, and if it's done in the early stages, they'll immediately bond.
Mm.
The sound of the cygnet
yes.
Will be recognised by the parent, they imprint, and they accept them as their own.
And how old are these cygnets, just out of interest?
They're probably only a week, 2 weeks old.
2 weeks old,
oh,
is that all they are?
Yeah, for two
yeah,
weeks,
yeah.
aren't they?
It's the role of a swan herd to look after the welfare of the birds, which includes feeding twice a day and conducting an annual census. In fact, swan herds have been keeping records of cygnets born at the colony here since the late 14th century. But that's enough swanning about for now, as it's time to get back to the property hunt to try and find John and Chrissy the perfect place to spread their wings. For our second property, we're travelling around 12 miles south of our first location, to the town of Wimborne. Officially titled Wimborne Minster due to the presence of a huge 1,300-year-old limestone church, this market town has a much busier and livelier environment than our previous house. There are plenty of shops, restaurants and conveniences housed in attractive historic buildings, some of which date back to the 16th century. And they are all within walking distance from our second property, which provides a very modern contrast to the ancient architecture of the town centre.
Oh, lavender again.
Yes, lavender again, but a rather more unusual house. Built in 2005. It actually won East Dorset House of the Year in 2005, the year it was built.
I can truly say I've never seen nothing like it.
The street aspect. No.
Is that
unusual.
A good thing or is that a bad thing?
I don't know. I really don't know.
I get a bit worried when she's lost for words.
Yeah. I suspect there's something on the other side.
Let's go and find out if you're right. Come on.
Yes.
This property is part clad in weathered oak, behind which is hidden a very unique house, designed by the current owners, who are well-renowned architects. Now, John in particular wants something contemporary, so that's exactly what we're giving him here.
Well, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
OMG.
Well, it's not what you expect.
It's what you said, though.
Yes.
I love the glass.
The glass is lovely.
This is unusual.
It's like a treehouse.
It is, isn't it? It's almost like having a conservatory and then the open space, your garden there.
Yeah. The outside is actually coming to the inside.
Yeah.
Our first impressions, I like it. It's modern, which I like. Contemporary. Yes, it's highly contemporary, which I like. I do like.
It's like something out of a magazine, isn't it?
It appeals to me.
Yeah?
Yep, I like. It does.
What about you?
First impressions.
I need to see some more.
Okay. Well, come on then. Let's go. And the open plan theme continues.
Yeah, flows.
Oh, right.
Flows nice. Flows nicely.
I do like that at the back.
Great place to have a dinner party.
Yes, it's really nice there.
And to me, this is the hub of the house. This is the entertaining area where you would sit and have your food and cook, chat while you're doing it.
And looking out onto that sylvan aspect.
I think it might be too modern for me.
Right.
Somehow, I don't know.
Open plan and modern is one thing in theory, though the reality does seem to be scaring Chrissy. But there's no doubt John is ready to seal the deal. I must say I don't blame him, for this is a truly remarkable house. Off the dining area, there's a compact study, and that takes us full circle back to the front hallway. This property features an upside-down layout, and the oak staircase leads down to the bedroom quarters on the lower ground floor, where there's also a utility room, as well as a luxurious, fully-tiled bathroom. In total, there are four bedrooms, and the windows in each one frame the natural habitat outside, so it almost feels like a painted canvas. There's a beautifully appointed twin room and two similar-sized double bedrooms, which just leaves the largest bedroom with direct access out to a private courtyard.
This is the master.
Bedroom's nice.
Yes.
Like the wardrobes. Lots of wardrobe space.
Lots of storage, yeah.
Love the window.
You've also got ensuite.
Ensuite.
Whirlpool bath. Yeah, have a look.
Whirlpool.
Very modern. Yeah.
Oh, the bathroom's lovely.
That's beautiful. Good size, yeah.
Really nice.
Love it, yeah.
So the idea is, you see, if you're lying in your bath,
yeah,
you're looking out onto water as well.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's called a vision pool, apparently.
Okay.
And then there's a little door leading out onto the garden. No diving in, okay?
Oh, the pool area.
Right, come on out.
Oh, right.
Big run up. You ready?
Oh, dear.
Oh, Chris, can you imagine doing this when you're 70 years old?
This is no good, Alex.
No?
No.
Why not?
Steep bank like that.
Just want to roll down
it? No, no, maybe children will, and cats might like running up and down it, but can you imagine me gardening here?
I'm not sure. You wrap around, you've got your garden from the front of the house coming all the way around, and this part they've just let overgrow. OK, well, let's talk money.
Money, let's say £699.
Wow, OK, £699,000.
Top of the budget. I think it's above budget. £720, maybe.
It's on the market for top of the budget. £700,000.
Really? Is it? Okay.
Oh, so I was the nearest.
You were.
699.
Touch
yes.
There's great joy in it. Yeah.
Yes.
That's a good guess, Chrissy.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's quite a high price to pay for something that I wouldn't really be happy with.
Okay, yeah. That's fair enough. Mm. Do you want to go and have another look around?
Okay. Right then.
Thanks. See you in a bit.
Later, yeah.
Right at the top of their budget at £700,000, this property meets much of our buyer's criteria, wrapped up in an outstanding contemporary finish. There's a spacious living room with sliding glass doors onto a huge decked terrace, a super slick kitchen flowing into a dining area, and four large bedrooms. The property also suits our reluctant drivers, being within striking distance of a lively town. But will the garden here make it too much of an uphill struggle?
Well, this is a nice room. This must be like a second bedroom. It looks nice and airy.
Good size again, Chrissy, yeah.
Well, when I first saw house number two, I was very surprised because I'd never seen anything like it in my life, I can truly say. It was very, very modern. And in fact, it was too modern for me, I would say. And for me, the house hasn't got the garden I would want. It's actually got a wild look at the back, which to me is a bit like a forest.
When I walked into the house, I was surprised, pleasantly surprised, because this type of house is the kind of thing I like. Modern, plenty of glass, open plan, and it really hit the spot for me. It really did. The lounge is the best space in the house. It's got sliding doors out onto the decking veranda, which is a really nice feature of the house. I don't feel enclosed in here. It doesn't feel small, and it flows lovely.
They've been in there long enough, I tell you.
Oh. Hello!
Ah, you took your time.
Well, John liked it so much.
I didn't want to leave.
Oh,
I like it.
Well, you're going to have to leave because it's not your house yet.
No.
Don't even tell me if it is going to be. Two very different houses today, so I think we'll go back and regroup. Start again tomorrow?
Yes.
As the sun sets across the Dorset countryside, we leave John and Chrissy to reflect on the two properties they've seen so far. With a budget of £700,000, London-based John and Chrissy have decided to quit the city for a rural home in Dorset, where they first met. So far, they've had a taster of traditional and a cut of contemporary. But coming up, the origins are rather confusing in the mystery property.
It's not a joke house, is it?
No, no, this is all for real.
No. It's not a museum, is it?
Well, it could be, couldn't it, I suppose?
And as for me, well, I'll be making tracks.
Well, it's the start of day two, and yesterday went rather well. We managed to find John his dream property in the second house. The only problem was that Chrissy didn't like the garden or the trees. I think we best leave that one alone. Bring on the mystery house, then. Trees aren't a problem. It's even got a sea view. Lack of transport might be, though. Will their ship come in? It's time to find out.
And to get to the mystery house, we're most definitely going off the beaten track.
You know, you are going to take up the driving again?
Yes.
Yeah, definitely.
We need to live in Dorset, we're going to have to drive.
Yes.
It's a good road, don't you think?
No.
This road is atrocious, Alad.
She's a horse.
If I had to walk down here, I think we won't be getting a car. We'd be getting
horse
a donkey
cart.
Or horse and cart.
Be good horse and cart along here.
Yes,
it'd be fun.
Yeah, I think so.
For our third and final stop of this property tour, we're heading southwest and straight towards the coastal wilds of Holworth. In fact, we'll be as close to the sea as you could possibly be without getting caught by a wave. The mystery property towers 200 metres above the former fishing hamlet of Ringstead and has a real feeling of seclusion. But the location is still close enough to civilization if needed, being less than 10 miles from the seaside town of Weymouth, which offers all the essential amenities. The gamble with this house is there's no public transport connections near to the property itself. Just a beautiful coastal landscape with commanding sea views. And just before the road tumbles down to the shore, we arrive.
Wow.
So.
Well, I don't know what this is.
It's the mystery property, that's what it is.
It looks like an old schoolhouse or...
It's actually a... An old Coast Guard house.
Oh, is it?
This was the boss's house, yeah. And then there are six other houses attached to it. Basically, We've brought you here because if you look that way, what do you see?
The sea.
If you look that
John,
way, what do you see?
Rolling hills.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh, and over there. Oh, it's beautiful.
It's beautiful view.
Yes.
Well, should we get in?
Oh, yes, yes.
Come on.
I might have to get a donkey.
Cutting an imposing figure high on the chalk headland, the mystery property was built back in the early 20th century to deter and catch smugglers. So let's step inside for a little time travel.
Two entrances to the property. This is the back one,
right,
through to
right.
a utility room. There's also a downstairs loo there.
Yeah.
Follow me through to the kitchen.
Oh, it's very quirky, isn't it?
Isn't it just?
Yes. Yes. Oh, this is an... Oh, it's lovely, this kitchen.
Isn't it just?
Yeah.
It's a nice feel to it.
It is.
It's old-fashioned, but it's been loved. You can see it's in good condition as well.
Yeah.
I can see that.
I love the kitchen. It's very country kitchen, isn't it?
So you've got the gas lamps?
No. Really?
No.
They don't still work, surely?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
God.
No.
Peaceful, isn't it? I love it.
It's not a joke house, is it?
No, this is all for real.
No. It's not a museum, is it?
Well, it could be, couldn't it, I suppose? But just lovely little features everywhere you look. Do you like it?
In today's modern world, I don't know. It's not modern enough for me.
Right.
I would find it quite hard to get used to this.
Well, let's see. We might change your mind.
Yes.
Let's go and have a look at the living room.
OK, then.
Come on, follow me.
Oh, this is another quirky room.
It's even a cosy little room,
yeah,
isn't it?
It's very cosy.
Again, great fire.
I know, the fires are wonderful.
Beauty, that, an absolute
That's
beauty.
That's even nicer
that
than
is.
The one in there.
See, I just want to sit down and curl to sleep now.
Yes.
You could be sitting here with your cat on your lap.
Yeah.
Next door, you also have a study, music room,
yes.
Which you could, you know, have as a little snug, another snug if you want, a little his and hers TV room.
But John did want lots of little rooms.
No, not particularly, no.
The mystery house is set out over three levels, and up on the top floor lie two bright and homely double guest rooms. Originally, the house offered a total of four bedrooms. As well as the two up in the eaves on the second floor, there were also two on the first floor. They've now been divided with folding wooden doors, which when opened, create a rather grand master, enjoying both rural views to the back and coastal views to the front. And that's where we're heading next.
Nice family bathroom with a roll-top bath. Come through to the master bedroom.
Yeah, quite spacious up here.
Oh, this is quite nice.
Oh,
yes,
surprise,
yeah.
Really surprised.
Yeah.
So you've got your own dressing area here.
Look at the view as well.
Dressing area for you,
yeah.
Sea views, rolling hills.
Yeah.
I know some of the rooms downstairs are small, because, you know...
Yeah, it's better up here.
I could see this house as a weekend retreat.
OK.
You know, not somewhere that I could live in every single day, but if I wanted to escape for a weekend retreat, it'd be some place like this.
This mystery house isn't for the faint-hearted. Sadly, it appears to be too remote for our city slickers. But we can't leave without checking out the pretty garden and soaking up those incredible and inspiring views. And it's little surprise that this property also comes with an artist studio.
Might as well take a seat.
Yes, this is wonderful.
Isn't it just?
Yeah,
yes.
It is nice. It's definitely stunning.
It is.
It's the only word for it.
It's a lovely location.
Well, let's talk money, because you never know. That might change
something. This is a hard one. I'm going for... 450.
Wow, right, okay. 450,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm gonna go up into the fives, I'm gonna say something like 525.
£525,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's definitely not 450.
Isn't it?
No.
No.
Nowhere near.
No. Well, I'd go by the old fashioned prices.
Right. Oh, right, okay. It's actually on the market for £575,000.
575, yeah, okay.
Well, listen, go and have another look around. And if you don't mind, I'll be up here waiting for you.
Okay, then. We'll do that.
Come on, Chrissy.
Again, under budget, with an asking price of £575,000, the mystery property is a Victorian three-storey, semi-detached, former Coast Guard's house and a rare opportunity to buy a part of Dorset's coastal heritage. It has two cosy reception rooms, a characterful and well-preserved kitchen breakfast room, and the potential for four bedrooms. But it's the dramatic and inspirational setting that makes this place so very special.
The house is charming. When you come into the kitchen, it is actually a lovely, cosy farmhouse kitchen, and it is very appealing. Although it's got that charm, it's too rustic in a way.
It's in very good condition, but it is like stepping back in time. I think I would sympathetically update it, keeping some of the traditional character of the property, and you've got the benefit of the outhouse as well. The outhouse was a nice space. You wanted to do any hobbies, any painting or something like that.
Hello!
I thought you were prolonging the journey back. You were dreading it. Seen enough?
Yes, I think so, yeah.
I think it's fair to say we've shown you three very different properties.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Certainly have.
Definitely.
You certainly
all different,
have.
Should we go and find somewhere where we can have a chat about them?
Yeah. Yes.
Come on.
It's safe to say that Dorset's winning combination of breathtaking coastline and vintage countryside makes an ideal retreat for a spot of R&R.
Ah, there's nothing like the British countryside, and where better than Dorset in the summer? Peace and tranquility. And tanks.
Oh yes, during the Great War, the British military were desperately trying to find alternative ways of overcoming the stalemate in the trenches. One mechanical solution was the secret development of so-called landships at Camp Bovington in the rural moorlands on Dorset's south coast. This location was ideal because tanks could easily be transported to the front line just across the water in France. And today the camp is still home to the Armour Centre for the British Army, part of which is open to the public. I met up with museum curator David Willey to find out more about the early deployments of these remarkable trench-crossing machines.
So I never knew that the German trenches were a little bit nicer than ours.
Well, the Germans, like this one, this is a recreation of a German trench we've got here. They were there to stay, that's the whole point. They occupy the ground, we've got the problem. How are we going to get them out? How are we going to push them back out of France and Belgium? And that's why the British come up with this thing, the tank.
This new armoured vehicle was designed to cope with all types of ground conditions, break through layers of barbed wire, and provide protection from artillery and machine gun fire. Little Willie was the first basic tank prototype developed by British engineers, who drew their inspiration from the Caterpillar tracked equipment used on farms in the USA. Although not an instant success, Willie paved the way for the Mark I tank, which was the first ever to be used in combat at the Battle of the Somme in September 1916.
Is it a complicated bit of machinery?
For the day, they are cutting-edge technology, but why don't we go and have a look at one and you can see for yourself?
Brilliant, come on.
Conditions inside the early tanks were cramped and appalling. Apart from the enemy, the crew of up to eight men had to contend with deafening noise, suffocating fumes, and intense heat.
So here we are, we're in what's called a Mark IV tank.
Right.
And this is the one they made the most of in the First World War. They made about 1,000 of these. This particular one is what they call a male tank. This one being a male has the bigger guns on the side, what they call 6-pounder guns. Female tanks just have two machine guns.
Why are all the tanks here then?
This is where all the tanks came back after the First World War to be chopped up for scrap metal. And the story goes that Rudyard Kipling, the author and poet, came down here in about 1923 on a visit and said, hang on, you ought to save some of those. They were very important in the First World War, and that was the start of the museum.
Modern tanks have now evolved beyond all recognition, and they're actually allowing me to have a go. Talk about big boys' toys.
I'm in.
Right, and then all I'm going to do now is pass you some ear protection.
Fantastic.
Yeah, complete.
Can't hear a word you're saying, so it's obviously working.
Copied and developed by countries all over the world, this original British invention has become a key weapon for the military, and even today constitutes an essential asset in land combat operations. And talking of assets, in the Battle of the Houses, which one of our selection, if any, will win? Let's find out.
Well, thanks for finding a nicer, secluded spot for us to have a chat. A bit windy, isn't it?
Straight to the country.
It is, yeah.
And we're the only ones brave enough to be out here.
Mad as hatters, aren't we?
Yeah. Well, I hope you've enjoyed it.
Oh, it's been great.
It's been marvellous. A good adventure and a good experience.
A few days, yeah.
Three really different houses.
Yeah.
Very different, yeah.
How did you feel when you walked up to that first one and you saw that thatched roof?
It really brought a tear to my eye. I actually got quite emotional.
It looked lovely. It's what you would imagine when you come up to a house.
You know, it was absolutely immaculate inside.
Yes, it was
a lovely house. Yes. There was only one drawback. It was really rural. It was nothing there. Mm.
Well, it had neighbours.
It had neighbours and a village pub.
Yeah.
And the people were very friendly. But there just was no shop. You couldn't even buy a newspaper there. You need a car to live there.
I think you're going to need a car wherever you live in the country, I think, aren't you?
I think we've discovered that. In the last few days, we found out that you do really need a car.
Well, let's talk about the second one. just wasn't modern enough.
Must we?
sorry. Hold her back. You loved it.
I loved it.
You said you didn't like it.
I didn't like it at all.
I hoped that it would be modern, and when we went inside, by golly, it was modern, and I really liked it. I loved it. For me, that was the type of house I like.
And then we showed you remote with the third one.
It was rural, but it gave you the sea, which I was willing to compromise on, and it also gave you the rural aspects, so it didn't feel totally rural.
Did you feel that you were cut off where you were in property free? Because you could see Weymouth, Portland, you could see a town in the distance, more or less, you know.
You loved the drive up, didn't you?
Oh, the drive up was, well, what can I say?
I mean,
definitely need a 4x4 car there.
You would.
Yes,
It was an amazing house, though.
Unbelievable.
If you want to get away from it, escape from the world, that's the house, really. Mm. Be a bit of a hardship to live there.
Do you think?
I think so, yes.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the second property was too modern, and the third property was too old-fashioned.
Too old-fashioned.
Which means that the first property is perfect.
The first property was my favourite, I would say, out of the three.
Mm. Right. So do you think you'll see any of them again? Realistically?
Not those
ones. Not out of the three, no.
No.
Not even the first one, then?
We'd rather get something where we can walk around.
Well, I wish you luck.
Thank you.
And I hope you do find that house with the sea view and rural views that's not too isolated.
We'll try our best.
And it's been great meeting you and lovely spending time with you. Well, I think it's fair to say that we showed Chrissy and John three very different properties here in Dorset. And all of them, on paper, had elements of what they're looking for in their dream house. But one thing is for certain, if they are going to make the move here, I fear they're going to have to jump back in that car. I wish them well. It's bye from me.
If you'd like to escape to the country in Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland or England and need our help, please apply online at bbc.co.uk/beyond